It's a common place to hear people talk about breaking the cycle of violence, of addiction, of emotional abuse. And the currency of the phrase represents a popular recognition that moral violence does more than harm us or injure us. It transforms us. It bends us out of our proper shapes. Lidsay Thompson and Sylvia Long-Tolbert have taken a look at the ability of some people to retain or regain their moral health in the face of moral distress.
I got started looking at this about 10 or 15 years ago when I started teaching a course called Leadership and Ethics for Business People. And it involved a lot of, like the course that was just described, a lot of narratives and conversations about situations at work. And so I learned about this concept of moral distress and met Cinda and Sylvia, and that's how I got into this. And a preview is our research problem was that all of the literature about moral distress until very recently has been just in clinical healthcare settings, and it has been mostly very characterized as very adverse and negative. And in my conversations with students and with different people that I had had conversations with, this wasn't always the case. Some people have really devastating experiences and they can bounce back. And other people seem to be mired in, you know, a downward cycle. And so I was really curious about what is the difference. And so I met Cinda and we started talking about what is that difference between people who somehow can experience something so negative and so destructive and they can rebound. And does this happen outside clinical health settings that had never been studied? So these are our results. We found that moral distress absolutely is not limited to clinical settings, that people are morally resilient, and that moral resilience, those factors of moral resilience, influence your ability to respond and the way you respond to situations that are distressing, and that whether you're resilient or not resilient, that experience is very consequential, not just for the employees themselves, but for workplaces. I used to be a health planner, so I kind of used a holistic health framework. And so I thought, if I'm going to look at this, I want to use a health well-being framework. And I thought, well, morality is a real essential dimension of well-being. I thought I would just Google it. Like, what if you're in cardiac distress, you know what it means not to be in cardiac distress. So if you're in moral distress, how do we define what it means not to be in moral distress? Well, there is no definition of that. So I thought, well, we'll make it up. We'll work on this. And so I did something really simple, two basic categories, looking at lots of literature. There's an intrapersonal cognitive inner capability dimension that's really well defined by REST. And then there's this sort of interpersonal relational dimension that's very well defined by feminist ethic of care. You could challenge these, but that's kind of a simple, well, two dimensions. And so that's kind of the framework that we use to set this up. And to define moral distress, I think if you read this, pretty much everyone has experienced this at some time or another. And moral resilience, on the other hand, is that ability to bounce back. And there are things about the contemporary workplace that really make this an important challenge for business and for the economy, because the workplace has changed so much. And I think a good example of this is the Wells Fargo situation. Many people spend more time at work than any other place. So
So a pair of former Wells Fargo employees are suing the bank for allegedly punishing them and fellow employees who would not engage in fraudulent activity. The suit is seeking more than $2.6 billion. The class action suit filed in California's Superior Court in Los Angeles County alleges employees were wrongfully penalized for being unable to attain aggressive sales quotas. Many of these quotas were met by employees who opened fraudulent accounts in customers' names without authorization. The lawsuit adds, the good employees with a conscience who tried to meet the sales quotas without engaging in fraudulent scams are the biggest victims of this scam. The plaintiffs are accusing Wells Fargo of wrongful termination, unlawful business practices, and failure to pay wages, overtime, and penalties. They are also alleging the bank was aware the unreasonable quotas were driving unethical practices. Earlier this month, Wells Fargo fired more than 5,000 employees for opening accounts in customers' names without their knowledge. The bank has been ordered to pay $190 million to settle the fraud case.
When we're here at CES, what does TiVo have to share?
This is just one example of the challenges we find most organizations facing in the 21st century. And what we realize that a good context for studying this issue of moral resilience would be in the service industry. Service industries dominate GDP and have for probably the last 25 years. What that means from a business perspective is that we generate most of our revenue from interpersonal encounters and delivering intangible services, and how we apply our knowledge and skills in a consistent way to create some competitive advantage. So we're no longer relying on well-calibrated machines and systems to actually make decisions. We're relying on people. And as the previous presenters have indicated, is that there's a lot of variability in the morals and values we bring to the workplace and how we apply them. So what's guiding our thinking from a business perspective are the tenets of what we call the service dominant logic. It has revolutionized how marketing thinks about creating value. And the three tenets that I'm going to focus on today is that competitive advantage is achieved through specialized skills and knowledge. The sustainable wealth is possible when firms really hone these competencies around these specializations, and that most value is co-produced in concert with employees and or customers. What that ultimately means is that interpersonal, intangible interactions and processes is the source of value. And a moral capability can indeed be a competency if there's an environment and culture that supports that and helps people to understand what good moral decision making looks like. And so with that in mind, Lindsay and I took two different paths in analyzing data that was collected via focus groups. We used a qualitative approach because we wanted people to express in their own words what moral challenges looked like for them. We had some pre-qualifying questions to ensure that we engaged people who had sufficient work experience and could kind of anchor against what they thought was good and bad. So we had a minimum age of 28, and for people who had worked at least 5 years. We used an interviewer guide that was adaptive and evolved over time because we realized we were missing some big pieces as people began to talk. And then the sample characteristics covered every industry and profession imaginable. So we had about 37 people across several focus groups. I'm going to turn this back over to Lindsay, who's going to talk about her project, and then I'll return to talk about the project that I pursued with the data that was collected.
So the first project is about the wicked workplace. We just like that phrase. And what we drew from the literature kind of as a background is based on a lot of science, neuroscience, and social sciences, and moral anthropology, neuroanthropology, is that human beings are oriented to thrive and flourish. We're not oriented to love moral distress or distress of any kind. And we have evolved with innate moral capabilities that we develop these capabilities through some internal learning, but through socialization. And that the way we develop these capabilities can be very elastic and variable, and we can actually devolve in our development of or undevelop moral capabilities. We're going backwards. Okay. So in our wicked work, we had three hypotheses, which you can read. I'm not going to read them. And we really unpacked, you've got a critical incident, and there are two factors that we looked at. There are endogenous factors interiorly, and exogenous factors in the environment and relationally. And so how you respond, do you compromise or are you resilient? And you're next.
The approach I took for the project that I presented is I framed moral distressing events as a service failure. We talk about service failures as it relates to external customers. We have well-established paradigms to help us understand how to recover when a failure occurs. And so what I've defined here as a critical incident is one in which you breached your own personal values and morals and how you actually reconcile that and move forward in the workplace. And what I came up with is I drew on the existing literature that all shifts the focus on internal employees as though they're customers. So I'm looking at internal marketing where we treat employees as customers. And if we indeed think employees are customers and our most valuable asset, then we need to think about ways to help them recover and be resilient when service failures occur. And so that was the basis for my analysis, looking at the employees as our most valuable asset in the service industry. We need to help them respond to these crises. There were several hypotheses that all established the fact that these moral resilience does occur, looking at the type of incidents that lead to these breaches and recovery, and also understanding what some of the other antecedents were. What I developed was a framework that builds on the classical service failure and recovery paradigm that we use to look at external customers and bring it in the organization. When employees have a breach of their own values, how do they muddle through and get back on the horse? Assuming that a breach in moral distress includes some sort of trauma which is in need of some sort of repair or restoration. And what we found is that people were indeed resilient across industries, and they can tell you how they repaired. Most of them self-repaired. Companies have no processes, policies, or resources devoted to helping employees recover from moral distressing events. And if we were in the external world where recovery was really the measure of success for most service organizations, internal service failures would get a zero in terms of performance, because people are self-repairing. So there are many social and public policy and theoretical issues in that people are morally impaired at work, and we let them leave the workplace and come back without giving them any resources to kind of shore up their moral foundation and to be morally healthy in doing the jobs that we expect them to do. And as the guest speaker said earlier, is that most of these are very trivial, mundane activities and events that operate below the level of consciousness, but people often reflect and understand that these breaches are chipping away at their moral compass over time. And I think organizations, especially service firms, have some obligation to figure out how we help people get on the path to moral wellness and well-being.